of exchange from circa 1200 to 1450. Our essential question is a pretty straightforward comparison question that asks for similarities and differences among the various networks of exchange during this time period. So our unit map, we're going to start with the Silk Roads, then we'll look at the Mongols and their effects on trade in general, then the Indian Ocean and Trans-Saharan. So these three are the main trade networks we're looking at. Then we'll look generally at some cultural and then environmental effects of those trade networks. Starting with the Silk Roads, we see it expanding during this time period and its effects on trading cities. We see innovations in transportation and commercial technology and the demand for luxury goods increasing. So some examples of the expansion would be, as we've mentioned, that Asian goods were in high demand way over here in Europe, such as gunpowder, silk, and porcelain. So that demand is what's driving the expansion of this trade. And we have some important trading cities like Kashgar shown here and Samarkand shown there that help to facilitate that trade. Because remember, the Silk Roads trade is what we call a relay trade. So traders are kind of going along this route. There aren't a lot of people loading up here and taking it all the way over here to the end. So those cities are important to help facilitate that. Some of the innovations like the compass and caravanserai allowed for trade on longer distance. The compass for navigation and the caravanserai would be those stopping points we talked about. Some commercial technology innovations are flying cash and the bill of exchange, which are forms of currency exchange that make it possible for traders from different societies to trade together. Here's an example of a bill of exchange. So we have the beginnings of the banking industry at this time, so people don't have to carry cash and lots of different currencies. And then we have trading organizations in which people joining together have some more strength, and the Hanseatic League in Northern Europe is an example of a collection of traders that gave them some political power so they could compete with states and empires. And we talked about things like gunpowder, silk, and porcelain being in demand, and also what happens is the demand for those goods helps to expand production in Asia for things like textile and steel. We talked in 1.1 about proto-industrialization in China and steel production. So all of these factors are helping to expand trade along the Silk Roads. And to review that section, our question was about the causes and effects of the growth of networks. So demand and transportation improvements helped to cause the Silk Roads to expand. And some of the effects was the rise of cities and oases, commercial innovations, and increasing production of goods. Now we'll go to 2.2 and the Mongol Empire. We're going to look at how it replaced other states, how they facilitated trade, and how they encouraged cultural diffusion. So Genghis Khan, you know, was the founder of the Mongol Empire, and he expanded his army and territory using superior military tactics, such as cavalry fighting from horseback and the use of siege engines shown here, especially in Europe. So the Mongol homeland is kind of right here in Central Asia and expands eventually to include everything in color on this map, and it's the largest land empire in world history. Some examples of its expansion are conquering the Song Dynasty and forming the Yuan Dynasty, conquering parts of Russia and forming the Khanate of the Golden Horde, conquering the Abbasid Caliphate in Persia, and forming the Ilkhanate of Persia. We use the term Pax Mongolica to describe a time of peace after all this conquest, and the Mongols encouraged trade for taxation to manage their empire. And if you look at the map here, you can see that it encompasses the entirety of the Silk Roads. So Silk Roads trade in particular really grows during this time period under Mongol unity. The Mongols also invested in infrastructure like bridges and roads and a messenger system that helped to unite the empire, all of which also facilitate the movement of goods. And then for cultural diffusion, we talked in Unit 1 about how the Islamic states had helped to advance science and technology. And so the Mongol Empire helps to connect the Islamic world and China together and also connect Europe to that as well. So we have a lot of movement of science and technology. It also helps to facilitate the growth of Islam, largely because of the Ilkhan Ghazan's conversion to Islam in Persia and the Ilkhanate of Persia becoming an Islamic state. And we'll see in 2.6 that a negative consequence was the spreading of bubonic plague again throughout those trade networks. So looking at how Eurasian empires grew and how their expansion influenced trade and communication was our essential question. So the Mongol conquest is really the reason the empires grew. So we have these examples of expanding empires. Influencing trade and communication was the time of peace and the expansion of the Silk Roads, the spread of plague, but also the spread of technology such as these examples. In 2.3, we're looking at the Indian Ocean Trade Network. We'll look at how it expanded, its use of innovation and technology, and the growth of states. So we have demand for goods like cotton from India, located right here. We have spices from Southeast Asia. slaves from East Africa, silk and porcelain from China, and horses and figs from Southwest Asia, all in demand. And you can see these circles are kind of connecting all the different routes of Indian Ocean trade. Some examples of innovation that helped make navigation possible were the compass and the astrolabe. And we also had ship designs like the lateen sail, this triangular-shaped sail, and the dhow shown here, which helped to move more cargo more efficiently. And also knowledge of the prevailing monsoon winds, which depending on the season go in two different directions, for instance, between India and East Africa, making it possible to navigate efficiently. And then as far as the growth of states, we have some examples of states that benefited from Indian Ocean trade, such as the Swahili city-state shown along here, the Sultan of Malacca shown here, which controlled an important trading route, the fact that Islam spread throughout this region from the Arabian Peninsula where it started to East Africa and to Southeast Asia and even into China. And we have the establishment of what we call diasporic communities. These are communities of people who have left their homeland and settled somewhere else. So we have an Arab community in East Africa along the Swahili city-states. We have Chinese traders settling in Southeast Asia. And we have the voyages of Zhang He, who was a Chinese admiral who sailed, shown on these red maps, during the Ming Dynasty throughout East Asia, Southeast Asia, all the way to East Africa. So our 2.3 essential question asked about the causes and effects of the growth of that trade network and environmental knowledge. So causes have to do with an increasing demand for products, the spread of Islam, innovations in transportation technology, and environmental knowledge. We just kind of wove in here to the causes section. And also the growth of cities and states helped to facilitate that trade. And some effects are the growth of those diasporic communities and cultural transfers facilitated by trade, such as the voyages of Zheng He. In 2.4, we looked at the Trans-Saharan Trade Network. We're going to look at how it expanded, innovation and technology there, and how trade fostered the growth of states. So the Trans-Saharan Trade Network expands throughout this time period to connect the Mediterranean cities, shown here, to West Africa along these trade routes, across Africa all the way to the Red Sea, which can help to bring the Indian Ocean trade, which would be over in this direction as well. The camel saddle is an important innovation during this time period, which allows these camel caravans to carry more goods. And we have oases, which are a lot of these dots here along the way, are places to stop. So these caravans, let's say between North Africa and Ghana, would be able to stop along the way. Some states that grew because of this trade were Mali, shown here, and later in the time period, the Songhe Empire, which expanded from where Mali was to the interior of Africa. And they are also responsible for some cultural transfers, such as the spread of Islam from North Africa down here to this region. So for causes of Trans-Saharan trade, we had transportation technologies and commercial practices like the transfer of gold. Effects would be the growth of states, especially in West Africa, like Mali and Songhe, and the spread of Islam to West Africa. And the second part of the question asked how they influenced trade and communication. So the Empire of Mali and the ruler in particular, Mansa Musa, was an example of someone who encouraged the spread of trade and the spread of Islam. And you can go to 2.4 for more information about that process. So now we'll look at the cultural effects of this trade in all trade regions. So we'll look at the diffusion of culture and technology, the fate of cities, and the stories of travelers. So the big cultural story for trade networks is the spread of religion. So we have Hinduism spreading, but the two main ones are Buddhism, shown here on this map, spreading from its founding point in India, both along the Silk Roads and along the Indian Ocean trade to East and Southeast Asia. And then we have Islam spreading from its home on the Arabian Peninsula through lots of trade networks, both the Silk Roads to East Asia, especially along Indian Ocean trade to Southeast Asia, and then along Trans-Saharan trades to much of North Africa. We also have the spread of technology like gunpowder and paper from China, and then maritime technology like the lateen sail, compass, and rudder, which helped to facilitate trade. During this time period, trade helped some cities to rise in importance, such as Hangzhou in China, which is kind of over here at the end of the Silk Roads trade network. Some decline because of political or agricultural instability like Constantinople, which is located right here in the Byzantine Empire and is conquered at the end of this time period. And finally, one factor in encouraging the development of trade networks is the story of travelers who experienced them. So Marco Polo traveled along the Silk Roads from Italy, right about here, all the way to China during the time of the Mongol rule in China. And his stories increased interest in overland trade to China. And then Ibn Battuta was an Islamic scholar who traveled throughout the Islamic world, Southeast Asia and Africa, and helped to demonstrate the cultural unity that Islam was providing in that part of the world. So our essential question asks for the intellectual and cultural effects of trade networks. So for intellectual effects, we have the spread of science and technology with these examples, And we have those travelers' tales who inspired exploration and the expansion of trade. And we talked about the spread of religions like Buddhism, Hinduism, and Islam as a cultural effect, and the fact that cities could rise or decline based on their relative power. Our last section is about environmental effects of connections, and we'll look at the diffusion of crops, some negative environmental effects, including the diffusion of pathogens. So one of the things that trade networks do is help encourage population growth by diffusing crops, such as the champa rice coming to China from Vietnam, bananas being spread from Indonesia to sub-Saharan Africa, and shown on this map, the diffusion of sugar, which initiated in Southeast Asia and spread during this time period along these trade networks and eventually to Europe, and citrus as well. Some negative environmental effects which can be caused by trade, especially the efforts to produce enough cattle or agricultural products, would be overgrazing, deforestation, and soil erosion, which make the quality of the soil go down and affect agricultural output. And then, of course, we had bubonic plague as an example of a pathogen being spread. The likely source of the plague was somewhere in East Asia, and you can see it was spread along the Silk Roads trade network. And the worst outbreak in Europe, the Black Death, was in the mid-14th century. So when we look at the environmental effects of trade, we can look at the introduction of new crops as a positive agricultural effect, such as these shown here, and negative effects being damage to soil and the spread of disease like the Black Plague. So this is just an example of some of the events on the timeline. It just helps to realize that some of the things we talked about, such as developments with the Trans-Saharan trade in Mali and the Mongols and then Silk Roads, are all happening at a similar time period. So just kind of consider that you could also do a chronological organization of this unit. So now to look at our overall essential question, it was a comparison, you remember, asking for similarities and differences about the networks of exchange. So when you're looking for similarities, it's good to have something that is common, or in this case, maybe is true for all three of them. And when you're looking for differences, you're looking for things that are less common, maybe only true for one or two. So some common processes were innovations in trade, like transportation or commercial technology, the way the trade networks support the building of states, such as in Southeast Asia, East and West Africa, the fact that they diffuse religion and culture, like Islam, Buddhism, and technology, and the fact that they physically expanded, and that's true for all three of these. Less common are the fact that under the Mongols, the Silk Road saw a period of political unity. Hinduism was a less common religion that was spread, really only along one of these trade networks, and that some of those impacts were negative, such as soil damage and spread of disease. So you could use these ideas to look for similarities and differences. And remember, if you were answering this question, the things you would be comparing would be these three trade networks. And if you found a similarity, it might be because it was true for two of them. And if you found a difference, it might be because these guys did it one way and these guys did it a different way. That's your Unit 2 overview. Happy studying!